Welcome back! My name is ballerscuba. This is Video Games Over Time! We are still in 1983. Today, we're going to talk about Dragon's Lair. The story of Dragon's Lair takes us to a company named Advanced Microcomputer Systems. Advanced Microcomputer Systems is an American video game company founded in 1982 by Rick Dyer. They released their first game in 1982, named Zizix. Zizix is a maze arcade game where the player guides Zizix, the protagonist, through the maze to collect gifts and bring them to Lola, the object of his affection. Dragon's Lair started as a concept by Rick Dyer. Inspired by Colossal Cave Adventure, Dyer created characters and locations for his own game. He then started choreographing the movements of the character as he overcame monsters and obstacles in his quest. By this point, AMS had an art department. They were put in charge of creating storyboards of each scene as Dyer created them. While working on the game, Dyer got the idea for a device that would play the game, which he named the Fantasy Machine. There were several iterations of the machine, starting with a version that used paper tape. Eventually, the machine would display still images and narration pulled from a video disc. This version of the Fantasy Machine played a game named The Secret of the Lost Woods. It was heavily inspired by Sega's arcade game, Astron Belt, which Dyer had seen at the 1982 AMOA show. Dyer tried to market the Fantasy Machine, but no one was interested. After watching the 1982 film, The Secret of NIMH, Dyer decided he would need high-quality animation and an action-oriented script in order to bring excitement to his game. Dyer decided to use a specific location from his game, The Secret of the Lost Woods, which had not been scripted yet as the basis for his new game. That location was Dragon's Lair. Dyer hired Don Bluth to animate the game. Don Bluth, the man behind The Secret of NIMH, is an American animator who had worked for decades in the industry. Initially, Bluth worked as an assistant at Walt Disney Productions for the film Sleeping Beauty. Bluth then worked for Filmation in the late 60s on television shows like The Archie Show and Sabrina the Teenage Witch. He then returned to Disney, working on animation sequences for Robin Hood and Winnie the Pooh and Tigger 2. He was promoted to directing animator while working on The Rescuers. He was then the animation director for Pete's Dragon, which was released in 1977. In 1979, while working on The Fox and the Hound, Bluth and Disney's studio executives started having disagreements. So Bluth resigned from Disney, opening up his own studio, Don Bluth Productions, with several other animators. Don Bluth Productions created an animated segment of the 1980 live-action film Xanadu before creating their first full-length animated film in The Secret of NIMH. The Secret of NIMH would achieve moderate success, but there was an industry-wide animation strike, so Don Bluth Productions had to file for bankruptcy. It was in this context that Don Bluth worked on Dragon's Lair. The game had a budget of $3 million, over $8.7 million in 2022. While high for a video game, this was fairly low for an animated film. As a result, the budget was a concern during development. Models proved to be too expensive, so in order to design the character model for the romantic interest of the game, Princess Daphne, the animators used photos from Playboy magazine. Voice actors also proved to be too expensive, so the animators would use their own voices for the characters, including Dan Molina voicing the protagonist, and Vera Lanfer voicing Princess Daphne. Only one professional voice actor would be hired to provide narration for the game. That was Michael Rye, who had previously provided several voices for Hanna-Barbera television shows. The music and sound effects were created by Chris Stone at EFX Systems. The programming for the game was done by Michael Naur and Vince Lee. In order to store the video game and all its animation, Dragon's Lair uses a Laserdisc. Laserdisc was still a new technology at the time. Laserdisc was originally released in 1978, developed by MCA, Pioneer, and Philips. A prototype of the game was shown at Chicago's Amusement Operators Expo in March 1983. For the full release, Advanced Microcomputer Systems turned to Cinematronics to publish the game in North America. Cinematronics is an American video game developer founded in 1975 by San Diego Chargers football players Dennis Partee and Gary Garrison. They would release their first game, Flipper, a Pong clone, in 1975. Cinematronics had their first success with Space Wars, a 1977 arcade conversion of 1962's Space War, the first conversion of the game to the arcades. It is said that Space Wars was the first arcade game to use vector graphics. After the success of Space Wars, Cinematronics would continue to release games using vector displays, although none of these games would be particularly successful. In 1982, Cinematronics began releasing games with a more traditional display. One of these games was Zizix, which we mentioned before was developed by Advanced Microcomputer Systems. However, with the decline of video game sales, Cinematronics had to file for bankruptcy protection. With the developer, the publisher, and the animation studio all relying heavily on Dragon's Lair to be a success, let's take a closer look at the game itself. Dragon's Lair is a new style of game for us. It's known as an interactive film. The player does not truly control the character in the sense that we have seen players control characters in previous video games. Instead, animated clips will play, and the player must input the correct button at the correct time in order to progress to the next clip. Typically, these inputs will control the protagonist at key points in the animation. Should the player not put in the correct input, a different animated clip will play, and the player will lose a life. The protagonist of the game is Dirk the Daring. Dirk the Daring's quest is to infiltrate the castle, go through several different rooms, and rescue Princess Daphne from the dragon. Dirk the Daring is a reluctant hero, often scared of what is put in front of him and hesitant to go through the obstacles presented to him. The game uses a lot of humor to entertain the player, especially with the death scenes when the player fails, which happens often. The game will randomly choose scenes for the player to play as the game progresses. As a result, the player may go through the entire game without being presented with every scene, and the player may be presented with the same scene multiple times. While the scene will always require the same inputs to be cleared, the scenes can also be flipped so that the opposite direction will need to be pressed in order to clear the scene. Dragon's Lair was published by Cinematronics to American arcades on June 19, 1983. For the European release, AMS would turn to Atari's European subsidiary, Atari Ireland. Atari Ireland would release the game to European arcades in fall 1983. For the Japanese release, AMS turned to Universal. Universal released Dragon's Lair to Japanese arcades in July 1984. That is the backstory to Dragon's Lair. With that now told, it's time to play the game for ourselves. And here we are in a version of Dragon's Lair. This is Don Bluth Presents Dragon's Lair. This is a difficult game to replicate. So the version that we are playing actually came out in 2016, which is by far the latest version of any game that we have played. But this is a game that is notoriously difficult to replicate because there is so much going on with the animation that I wanted to give you guys as close to an original and complete experience as possible. And that means that we're going to have to play two different versions of this game. So let's go ahead and start a little bit here, and we'll see all the options that we have. You can see my mouse. That's the first time that you've been able to see my mouse, I believe, in any game that we have played. We'll start with the extras. So we're going to start with attract video. So the attract video is the term that they use for what I've been calling the demo in most games. This is what you can play to try to bring people into the game. And that's where we typically start these, so that's where we're going to start now. So we will start with attract video. And let's see how they're trying to draw me into Dragon's Lair, how they're trying to sell me on this game.
Dragon's Lair, the fantasy adventure where you become a valiant knight on a quest to rescue the fair princess from the clutches of an evil dragon. You control the actions of a daring adventurer finding his way through the castle of a dark wizard who has infested it with treacherous monsters and obstacles. In the mysterious caverns below the castle, your odyssey continues against the awesome forces that oppose your efforts to reach the Dragon's Lair. Lead on, adventurer. Your quest awaits.
And that's how they try to draw you into the game. Now, this game is very difficult. I'm not going to beat around the bush on that one. This version of the game does allow me to make it easier, and I would argue possible without hours and hours of tedious memorization. So we're gonna try to do the original version, and then we're going to give up and do it in the way that makes it possible for me, at least, to go through it. So we will play the game. We're gonna do a new game. I have played this game previously. To make sure I knew what I was doing. And I have done it for the channel in the past, but we'll talk about that probably at some point. So we're going to play the original arcade. Arcade cabinet on, mood guide off. Are they going to just let me select arcade mode here? No. So move beeps off, move guide off. Mode arcade, arcade cabinet on. And hard is... I'm trying to remember which one the actual arcade does. It doesn't really matter because we're not going to be able to do it no matter what. We'll do difficulty on hard because I believe that is what the arcade originally did. But like I said, we have no chance of making it through this. So let's do what we can. Yeah, Dirk will start in a new scene if he died in arcade mode. Yeah. Let's see what we can. So we have a joystick and we have the sword button. All right, random scene we go. And here. Okay, so far we're doing okay. I am putting the buttons in. And I have died. All right, and off we go on the horse. And I have died. I didn't hit the button. Which button? Good question. Go this way? Nope. And I have died. Game over. That's how quick this can happen. If you don't know what buttons to press, you don't know when to press them, you're going to die. So it is one of those games that attracts a lot of people that like to memorize things, like to get better at games. We're going to do one more run at this so we can see a couple additional scenes, but then we're going to abandon it. All right. Nope. I tried hitting the sword button. That didn't work. Okay, so... And I missed it. I missed the jump. And there's my second life. All right, third life. Let's get my mouse off the screen. And I have died. So... We're going to quit this now. High score? Sure. There we go. High score because I'm the only person to have done it on this particular machine. All right, so now we're going to play the game on what I'm going to call the proper difficulty. This time we're going to do move beeps on. It's going to beep when I actually need to hit the button. It's going to have move guide on. That's going to tell me what button to press. We're going to turn the arcade cabinet off. We kind of got to look at that. I want to look at the actual game, not necessarily what the cabinet might have looked like around it. The home version, that way in case I died, we can actually finish that scene. And we're going to turn on easy difficulty so that I can actually make it through, which would be nice. But it also gives me more time to actually make it through. And then once we go through the game, you saw there was an option for watch the game, basically, and it'll show you all the deaths and all the successes and all that kind of stuff, so we'll actually get to see the game in full. So that'll give us... That was the accurate experience before, but now let's actually try to make it through the game legitimately-ish. And that way we can actually see the ending, and then we'll watch the complete version of the game. So, let's do what we can here. There's the move guide at the bottom. Did I not do fast enough? No. Alright, my reaction time's a little slow. I get caught watching the animation, which is going to screw me over. I'm just going to watch the bottom. You can see I hit the button and we have succeeded. There we go. In the castle we go. Nope. Alright. It's going to take me a little bit to get my reaction times back. Do we really have to start from here again? The game requires intense reaction times, and if you don't even know you're supposed to press a button when that happens, you know, chances are things aren't going to go well for you. Alright. Yeah, you guys get to watch the film, basically, and I get to watch the bottom. This requires a lot of concentration, but we made it through. Save me. What button was I supposed to hit here? Up. Nah, I hit the wrong button. All right. Let's try this again. This time we're going to do better. I can do this. Just takes intense concentration. At least we're starting here, I guess. I hit the button twice there. You didn't count it? They did count it. Okay. It just didn't beep for me. You gotta get the timing right on this. After the ball passes is when you go. Nope. That was such a quick one there. And this is on easy mode. Imagine what you have to do on hard mode here. Down, 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 come on, up, like right at the end there, you have to be right on top of it. I feel like they repeated that scene there, but what do I know? Alright, got my sword. Can you imagine just randomly guessing that's the timing on when you have to use the sword for that? I'm trying! Don't get the diamond, apparently. Fight the snake. Alright, new one for us. Nope, that was the wrong button. I hit the sword for some reason. I don't know why. We were doing so well. We made it through there. While he was swinging the sword, I needed to hit the button. Same there. Nope. Okay. And I have failed. So now I'm just going to have to turn on infinite lives to make it through this. Because we are not making it through. You have to go through a certain number of scenes before you can unlock the end. That one was not bad. We'll put in my initials on that one, actually. Alright, so how'd I do? You know, not bad. 70,000 points. Not bad. Alright, so let's turn this on. Let's do a new game. And we will do... Can I turn on infinite lives? How much are you... Oh, you're only going to let me do 3 or 5? Ooh. Alright, 5 lives it is. Let's put my skills to the test and see if I can actually make it through it on the easiest settings that this version of the game offers. We do have to kind of start over on it, unfortunately. Alright, into the castle we go. We're doing kind of the same pattern here as we did before. That's strange. But we made it through and we lost our mechanical horse. Through that one. You were still telling me up. No, why? The button presses threw me off. It that was very strange. What was happening on my screen? Yeah, this one might do me in. What are we doing here? See, you told me up and then I hit the button and then you take it away from me. We go. I missed it? How did I miss it? What is going on here? The button presses aren't being nice to me today. Okay, there, we made it through that one. There. Okay, we've done this one before, so I know it a little bit. But yeah, the move guide is not helping me out as much as it needs to lately. You have to follow the pot, basically. Then you can get your sword finally at the end. I think I missed the last one, but they gave it to me anyway. Alright, we made it. Flaming sword that turned him to stone somehow. I wasn't paying enough attention. Don't drink random potions, Dirk. Right that way. Oh, we all right. Stuttered there for a bit. Right, we have seen this one before. No! I thought we went right at that point. No! Am I out? I am. Alright, we gotta try again. I think I'm gonna give it one more try, and if I can't do it, then we'll just watch the video of making it all the way to the end. But I should be able to get through this. I have done it before. Okay. Timing on that one, I remember being bad. What kind of castle is this? Nope, wrong button. And off I go to my doom. Alright, try to attack him. Get out of the way. Get out of the way. Keep going. Alright, we made it through. Nope! I expected it to go the other way, right? This is one of the ones that's mirrored. And they didn't let me know until kind of the very end there. Okay, here. This guy again, and it's backwards. I don't think that'll matter too much to me. Okay. I think this one's backwards too, though. Not sure how much. Yeah, there was only the one button press that changed as a result of that. This one again. Alright, back to this one. Hard timing at the end. We're getting better. And that's how this game is played. You just slowly get better. First you know nothing, and then eventually you learn a little. That timing is still very specific. I hit the button, did it not? It was too slow. Nope, that's the wrong button. Alright, are we done or? Okay, we got one more. I'm trying! It's difficult. Don't get that, just go forward. Nope. And that's the end for me. Alright, so today it's not in the cards, it looks like. I cannot do it today. So, instead of continuing to try, I can link my previous run of it where I believe I was finally able to do it. But for now, we will just go ahead and watch it. Sure, I'm not particularly proud at this point, but there we go, 90,000. That's my high score. We'll go ahead and watch the game, and we'll get to see all the different clips from the game, everything that is possible about it, and that will help, I guess. Let's watch the game. Deaths, we'll start with deaths off. This is what it looks like when you go through the game in full. You know what? We'll turn deaths on. We'll get to see all the different deaths. along the way, because the deaths are honestly some of the best parts of this game. So we'll just play it with all the deaths on. I consider just doing the death offs first and then the deaths on, but let's not watch it twice. Let's just go through it in full now. And we get the entrance here, and then I believe we will start with deaths before we move on to what happens if you fail. No, we start with the live. You get to live first. And then they do point you that direction, but that's what happens if you die there. That's what happens if you die there. All right, next scene. Yeah, there's lots of back and forth with this one. You can die there. You just get squeezed. The tentacle monster is after you. Alright, next one, snake. Chop it. Chop it. Yeah, this one we did a few times. That last timing is difficult, though. You have to do it before you know what you're doing. Otherwise, you're not going to make it. Do you remember this one? Well, I only have vague memories of these because I was paying so much attention to the bottom of the screen. Just trying to hit those buttons. The timing on it is so particular. Alright, so you make it through. So many ways to die. Yeah, that spider. Luckily we didn't get to see Dirk crushed. I was able to make it through that one. Don't drink the potion. Everything is out to kill you. That one doesn't seem too difficult, but I'm sure it's much more difficult than it looks. As you can see, you can die in several different spots, which means that had several different button presses. I don't think I ever heard him humming while I was playing. I was too focused on everything else. You can die sliding. You can die there. You grab that and water comes at you. They tricked you with that one. Oh, it looks like the one that we played was mirrored because I remember that coming from the other side. And then we light it on fire, which makes this guy come to life, so then we swing our sword and turn him back to stone for some reason. You can get put on fire, you can get stabbed, you can get maced, you can get hit with the anvil, you can get speared, and he can kill you. So much death. Then we got these. I want to reference something, but I don't think it's around yet. We'll reference it later. You can wait there for a while, it looks like. They give you many opportunities. But then these button presses were so particular. Like, you still basically had to know what button to press. That's how quickly you had to react to a lot of this. Oh, I want to, Princess Daphne. We didn't get to see you because we didn't even make it to the dragon's lair. That's how bad I was at that. Yeah, don't go for the diamond. I don't think we saw this one. That one was not too difficult, just the one button. But we can fail in so many ways. This one I think we were fine on. Yeah, just don't go that way. And then, oh, there's so many deaths that you can do on this one. I think I only died once during this one, though. And then you make it, and then, yeah, the fire comes at you at the end. You can just run into everything here. I don't think we ever even made it to this one. Oh, I remember this one from my previous playthrough. It is so weird. I don't know how, like, outside of just playing this scene over and over again, I don't know how you know. Every time he jumps, you have to hit a button. How you're supposed to guess that without even really looking, I'm not sure. Yeah, that's what happens when you fail. Or he could hit you. But there were at least 7 or 8 button presses in that one. This one at least makes a little bit more sense. You move, you attack, and then you move again, right? But the one where you just jump kind of seemingly in random directions, that one was insane. Yeah, you can just die to everything in here. Oh, they put you in the coffin! Alright, you make it through that. Or you could die. Or the bats could get you. I think this is a new scene. Yeah, this is a new scene. This one wasn't too bad. It was just that one jump was so difficult. But all the bats can get you and you can fall down there. Alright. Oh, we saw this one so many times. Yeah, you can just kind of keep falling for a while. They give you a lot of opportunities here, but man, you hit the button at the wrong time, you're screwed. You can make it through. Or you could die there. Oh, we saw this guy. Yeah. Did we fail in this one? We might have. There were so many button presses for this one. I'm sure it's all the same death animation, though, because it's the same attack animation from the king when he's going for you. But yeah, you have to follow the pot, and you don't have a lot of time to figure out which way the pot is going. And you attack him several times. Yeah, you can just get hit in the head so many times, and then he drags you off. Drink me, don't do it! If you drag him, yeah, you die. Or you get burned. That's always an option, too. We got like a seesaw thing going here. There's so many ways to die. And we're still not even through to the end of the game here. But yeah, that starts going after you. I vaguely remember this one, but we didn't see it today. Can make it through, but you can also just die. We have more scenes. This game is so loaded with scenes that you don't really have to go through. I believe you have to make it through like 6 in order to make it to the end of the game. That seems to be the number that I remember, but I could be mistaken about that at this point. It's been a while since I've made it through, but you have to make it through so many. And they're all very difficult. And people that have memorized this game, like, you better keep it up, because this could easily be forgotten if you don't play it for, like, 2-3 weeks. You could forget every button press that you're supposed to do, especially if you didn't write it down. But yeah, you can make it through the rapids in your barrel. Like, this is the Hobbit. You grab onto that, and you make it out. Or... look at all the places you can die. Oh yeah, Dirk just forgets to grab the thing. That could happen too. I think we ended up making it through. Oh, is that what happens? I was wondering. They grab your sword. Because I was not paying attention. They just wanted your sword. Then we eventually made it through this, right? And they just keep chasing you. Yeah, I vaguely remember making it through this. Or all this could happen to you. Oh yeah, we never did get to see the Black Knight for this one. This guy is difficult. You can get hit by the brambles, you can get hit by him. And that's apparently it. Yeah, the balls. This one, at least I feel like the game gives you visual cues to know what you have to do and when you have to do it. So I'll give that to this scene as opposed to some of the other scenes that we have done. But that timing on that last one is very difficult. You get run over by everything. We died on this one several times. I believe I made it through at some point, though. Caught there, you can get electrocuted, and then you can get hit by the lava. And here we finally are at the end. There's our Playboy bunny. And there's the dragon. Hi there.
With a key, the dragon keeps it around his neck. To slay the dragon, use the magic sword.
I'm not gonna lie, I only heard about half of that. They drew her very well and made her very flirty there. Yeah, this part is difficult because it keeps cutting to her, and you don't do anything on her stuff, so like there's time to relax, and then she's very distracting, and that's how they designed her. Right? We're in the middle of a battle, don't cut to the princess! Then you finally defeat the dragon, you get the key. Pop the bubble. And she just jumps into your arms. And you get the kiss on the cheek. It looks like on the mouth for a little bit, but no. These are all the ways the dragon can kill you. And that's the game. So, with the game now shown and vaguely played, just not played well, it's time to talk about how the game holds up today. Playing the game today, the game is definitely fun, but the game is incredibly difficult, and it becomes very frustrating for newcomers very quickly. And a lot of that is the gameplay. The gameplay is the hardest thing about the game, and it is the thing that is least accessible to a modern audience. The gameplay did not have a name in 1983, but later on in video game history, we would refer to this kind of gameplay style as quick time events. And the emphasis is on quick, definitely, for Dragon's Lair. And quick time events kind of have a mixed opinion on whether that is a good type of gameplay or a bad type of gameplay among a lot of the video game audience. So if you are a fan of quick time events, you might like this game. If you're not a fan of quick time events, you're definitely not going to like this game. The short amount of time that you have to press each individual button means that even if you have the game memorized, there's still a good chance that you will fail at some point during your play of the game, because there's just not a lot of time to figure out what it is you're supposed to do. And even if you do know what it is, the window is so short, you might miss it. But the graphics are definitely the standout of this game. It looks like a film. It looks like a Don Bluth film. It looks like The Secret of Nim. So it's definitely miles ahead of anything that we have seen in any of the other games that we have played. Everything else is represented by pixels. This is hand-drawn animation, and it looks very good in certain points. It's a little choppy at points, and the animation goes very quickly because of the limited storage space on the Laserdisc, I am sure. But the animation itself looks amazing for a video game in 1983. It looks like a film, And that was what it was trying to go for. In terms of the sound, I think the sound was, you know, pretty much on the quality of a film, except when it came to the voice actors. It's hard not to look at Princess Daphne's voice and go, it's not quite where you would expect it to be for a film of 1983. But for a video game, the fact that I can compare it to a film is amazing. So it is basically a film. It's basically an interactive film, as the name of the genre kind of suggests. And it's the first one. It is the first one that kind of goes this direction, and it does it pretty well. The only issue that I have with it is the difficulty level. And because I wasn't at my best today when it came to the timing, I was unable to actually beat the game the way that I had done in the past. So I will put a link in the description below to me playing it for the channel before we started this project. But the game, like I said, is fun. In terms of a replayability factor, that's the only way that you can beat the game. You have to memorize everything. So if this is something that interests you and trying to memorize all the button presses, especially in the original version, then this is a game that I can recommend for you. If you are not interested in QuickTime events, or you just want to watch, then I have provided the watching. But if you want to just kind of get through the game on the easier difficulties, then it might be something that interests you. But if you're not a fan of QuickTime events, or you're not a fan of Don Bluth in particular, then this is not going to necessarily interest you. And that's my modern take on the game. When the game was released, Dragon's Lair had a lot of pressure on it. The game was seen as the first in a wave of new immersive Laserdisc games. Because of the cost behind the game, Dragon's Lair was the first game to cost 50 cents to play in the United States instead of the usual 25 cents. Arcade operators were also worried that the scripted nature of the game would lead to players learning the game and stopping playing once they had it memorized. Despite these concerns, the game proved to be successful. By July 1983, Dragon's Lair had distributed 1,000 units in America, while they had a backlog of over 7,500 units. The game proved so successful that a couple publications said the game would be responsible for saving the declining video game industry. By the end of February 1984, the game was reported to have earned over $32 million for Cinematronics, over $86.5 million in 2022. However, the release was not without difficulty. The technology behind a Laserdisc was typically used to play films, which would play a Laserdisc from beginning to end in full. In Dragon's Lair, sections of the Laserdisc are randomly chosen by the programming, so the Laserdisc is constantly seeking for different sections to play. This proved to be faulty, as many of the players could not handle this constant use. The arcade cabinets would need lots of repairs as a result. The original Laserdiscs also had quite a bit of loading times. During this time, the screen would go black. This would prove to be the largest complaint from players and critics. However, despite these issues, the critics loved Dragon's Lair. The animation was not only praised, it was seen as the beginning of the future of video games. In 1984, though, the popularity of Dragon's Lair started to drop off. Views of the game also started to change, with many seeing the game as more of a fad than anything else. It was seen as not living up to the hype that people inside and outside of the industry put on it. As time has gone on, though, the game's reception has come back to being positive. Dragon's Lair is seen as one of the best video games of all time. Dragon's Lair would see dozens of ports over the years, as well as several sequels. We will pay attention to some of these as we continue. Dragon's Lair would also reach the mainstream, making it to film and television. the game would prove to be influential, just not up to the hype put up around it. With the initial success of Dragon's Lair, Rick Dyer and Advanced Microcomputer Systems would continue to work in the industry. We will hear from them again. We will also hear from Cinematronics, as this success would help get the company through their bankruptcy. We will also hear from Don Bluth again, as this would not be the only video game he would help design. That will do it for the story of Dragon's Lair for now. My name is Baller Scuba. This has been Video Games Over Time. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in our next video when we find gold.